It's a pleasure to have this program today. Especially, I'm so proud that we have this program with Wagner's College, especially with Lori Weintraub, professor of history and director of Holocaust Education Center. She's doing a phenomenal job for all Holocaust survivors, and we are so proud that three of them are our CLLD members as well. Not only three, I think more, four of them are our Holocaust survivors and CLLD members. And it's so great that we can do it during our cinema club. The most popular program, I can say, at our CLLD program. Every Thursday we have this unique program, and today is a very special one. So I want to introduce Lori, and she will introduce the program. Thank you, Lori, for coming.
Hello, welcome everybody, and thank you for inviting Wagner College to the JCC. The JCC has been incredible in supporting the efforts of the Holocaust Center over these past 3 years. I've been teaching Holocaust studies at Wagner College to college-age students, working with some local teachers for about 20 years, but over the past 3 years, we've really intensified our efforts and reached out to 6 local schools. We've had 10 individual Staten Island Holocaust survivors speak at local schools, including 2 of them in the room, one whose story you'll see today, Arthur Spielman, who spoke at Port Richmond High School and PS 19, and one whose story you won't see today, we'll have to save for another day, Shirley Gottesman, who spoke at Lavelle Preparatory Charter School to 9th graders there. So what we've been trying to do at Wagner is to match local Holocaust survivors and their stories. For some of them, they've never been recorded. Others were recorded in the 1990s from the Shoah Foundation. They're one of the 58,000 stories that the Shoah Foundation recorded in 60 different countries in many different languages. But luckily, Wagner has its own Steven Spielbergs, its own film students, and they have been able to rescue these stories that were sitting 2 hours long, 3 hours long, in an archive in California, and turn them into beautiful 12-minute documentaries that you're gonna watch today. So one of the main things I'm gonna do in a minute is introduce the student, Cameron Hafner, who's been working on this for 2.5 years and has created so far about 7 films about Staten Islanders like yourself, but born in Europe, and who underwent and showed tremendous resilience during the Holocaust. The 3 stories that you're gonna see today follow Jews that were born in Germany, on the border of Romania and Hungary. And the middle story is actually from someone from Krakow, Arthur, who survived by hiding in Hungary and Slovakia. So you're gonna be seeing these different stories in video format in these documentaries, and we really look forward to hearing your questions and thoughts and you know, anything you might wanna share about how the Holocaust Center can best serve young people on Staten Island in the tri-state region or around the world through these digital projects that we're creating. So as I said, I'm actually here with 2 students today, each representing a different part of the mission of the Holocaust Center. One works on the education arm, Loriana Rosado. I'm gonna just ask her to stand up. And she actually has been to the concentration camps in Germany, Ravensbrück in particular, and is now working for the next 1.5 years to strengthen Holocaust education in local elementary, middle, and high schools on Staten Island. So she is one of the newest members of our team of college students and graduate students who are working on Staten Island to strengthen Holocaust education as a way to fight against anti-Semitism and prejudice, and with the rise of hate crimes, including the hate crime last week at the JCC of Staten Island, there's not a better moment to strengthen Holocaust education. And so she'll be working with local principals and teachers. And if you have any suggestions for particular schools, maybe your grandchildren are in, please let us know. She is originally from Valley Stream, New York. She went to undergraduate school at Wagner and is now a graduate student on the way to becoming a full-time teacher. And again, her experiences with this internship will shape her teaching for decades to come. In addition to the survivors, the main person I want to introduce today is one of the first interns for the Holocaust Center at Wagner, Cameron Hafner. He's going to speak in a few minutes. To say that he has put in thousands of hours studying Holocaust testimony and looking for documentary archival footage really just begins to suggest his role in being a student who cares deeply about the Holocaust. He does have Jewish heritage as well as non-Jewish heritage, and he's brought so many of his talents and interests to the Holocaust Center. He's one of the leaders of the Film Society at Wagner, president of the Film Club. He is from Florida originally and won many awards, including one of his film was the Geico National Safety Contest winner, first place, and he was able to show a short film at the Naples International Film Festival. So he's very talented. He came to Wagner almost 3 years ago, one of those semesters he spent in Australia studying film. And since he came to Wagner, as part of his work with the Bonner Leadership Center at Wagner, as well as the Holocaust Center, as I said, he's really devoted himself to meeting with Holocaust survivors, including meeting personally with Margot, Capell, and Hannah Steiner, and Arthur Spielman. And he's really dedicated himself to using this material of the Holocaust to promote the betterment of our young people, to make them more conscious of the dangers of prejudice and anti-Semitism, and to use Holocaust education and the memory, the need to never forget, to make it really a reality. So today is the beginning of this very important moment where we're celebrating with the entire international Jewish and non-Jewish community, International Holocaust Remembrance Day, January 27th, when the Soviet troops, the Allied troops, liberated Auschwitz. Now I'm going to ask Cameron Hafner to come and speak for a few minutes about the process of creating the videos, the films that you'll be watching, and other video and film digital work he's been doing at Wagner College. And then we will show the film Margot Capell's story first, then Arthur Spielman, and then we will see Hannah Steiner's tragic story. And between each of the films, I've asked each of the survivors just to speak for 3 or 4 minutes about one story about their childhood. And then at the end, which should be in roughly an hour, we'll break for question and answer, and there should be 45 minutes for any questions or answers you might want to ask about, you know, their loss, their resilience, their languages, anything that you might think of. So with that, I'm going to call Cameron Hafner to speak about the process of creating, being a Holocaust intern, what it's meant to him as a Wagner College student, as a young person, and why he is so happy to have all of you here to join us in this effort of remembering the Holocaust and never forgetting. Thank you.
Thank you, Lori. So hello, everyone. My name is Cameron. Yes, it is truly an honor to be here today because I had no idea this was a film society. And being a president of the Wagner College Campus Film Society, this is really essential to our mission to show films and tell stories to a variety of audiences. And so this is actually a very special moment to be able to show these videos to you guys today. I started working with Lori about 2.5 years ago, my freshman year, and it's compelling because I'm a filmmaker. I'm obsessed with Spielberg's films, finding stories that need to be told and the urgency of telling those stories, I think are essential to the work that we have to do within the coming years. And so working with Lori Weintraub in the Holocaust Center, I've been able to consume hours and hours of testimony, understanding all these details that are all so different between each video. But what's so consistent between all these videos that I watch is this message of how stories will liberate us and how stories will get us through these tragic circumstances. Whether it's, you know, listening to Margot Capell and how she sneaks into Shirley Temple movies, you know, because she loves Shirley Temple, or hearing how Hannah Steiner survived living through the tragedy of Bergen-Belsen by listening to the stories of her mother and how she met her father. It's really inspirational. And that's really what I find most compelling about these videos. To find more students who are interested in these stories and who will sit down and watch these 2-hour long testimonies to hear the stories, you know, hear these stories that haven't been told or that people aren't listening to. And it's important that we, you know, expose more people to these stories, because these stories will be lost if we don't continue to tell them over and over. Margot Capell has a sort of creative little opening, so we hope you enjoy it, and then, yeah.
Animal crackers in my soup, monkeys and rabbits, loop the loop. Gosh, oh gee, but I have fun swallowing animals one by one.
We were not supposed to go to the movies. However, they always told me, because I was a movie buff, you know, as a kid. I remember the Shirley Temple movies and all that, and they would smuggle us in once the lights were out, and we would leave before the lights go out, go on again, sit in some obscure row and see the movie. So there were people like that, not too many, but there were some who were good.
Why would the Nazis prevent a young Jewish teenager from watching her favorite film stars? Holocaust education, when it exists, focuses on the destruction of Jews in Europe in World War II. But what about before all this? How did the Nazis manage to turn an entire country against an entire ethnic group? These are the questions that lie at the heart of Margot Capell's journey from eyewitness to war refugee. Here, Margot Capell recalls her childhood growing up in Edigheim, Germany. Edigheim was a small town located in the southwest region of Germany, near the border of France.
The only thing I can say about Edigheim, we were surrounded by Gentile neighbors, and I don't think I ever felt any different from anybody else. I had Gentiles, I had Jewish girlfriends, and we got along fine.
When Margot turned 8.5 in the year 1928, her family, consisting of her mother, father, and brother, decided to move to the larger rural town of Welsheim to help take care of her grandfather.
We were totally integrated into the local community, and I know that was there a Jewish festival and anything, the Catholics, which was the only other religion in our town, could do to help, they would.
With religious Jews and Catholics coexisting in this primarily agricultural town, it wasn't obvious or apparent that there were any tensions. But this would slowly start to change.
My brother, who had been out, he's much older than I am, he was out that evening with friends, and he had come home and he surprised somebody who was trying to break in. And at that time, we didn't think that it had anything to do with anti-Semitism. However, when he tried to go to the police and have it investigated, they just ignored him. They wouldn't do anything.
Soon, word spread of Nazi rallies and street fights. While Nazi candidates for election blamed the poor economic state of Germany on communists and Jews. And due to Germany's wounded national pride after their defeat in World War I and lack of political stability after the 1929 depression, Germans began to listen to what 40-year-old Hitler and the Nazi Party were saying. Many Germans wanted a stronger nation, and if it meant more anti-Semitism, that was okay.
Of course, Hitler never held back. He always said what he was going to do, and of course, nobody took him at his word, but except my uncle. I remember my uncle coming home to Wilsheim, telling him he's going to get out of Germany because what's going eventually happen, all the Jews will have to go or else they're going to be killed. Well, as that was in 1930, everybody laughed at him and thought he was a little bit off. But he didn't, he said no, he said you will think of it, you will think of my words. And unfortunately, whatever he said came true.
By 1933, Hitler was appointed as chancellor, and the Nazi Party became the largest and then the only party in Germany. Back in Wilsheim, there were boycotts against Jewish businesses, starting on April 1, 1933. As Jewish teachers fled, Margot was transferred from a Hebrew school to a Catholic school, where she eventually became the only Jewish girl in her class.
You could tell that people wouldn't look you in the eye anymore when you met them on the street, and before you would even holler across the street, "Hi, how are you?" and they would turn their head and make believe they didn't see you.
The force of anti-Semitism grew with the passage of the 1935 Nuremberg Laws, enforced by local police under Heinrich Himmler. Some Jewish families started taking action to leave the town. Margot's brother left Germany that year to live with a relative in Sweden. In Catholic school, the nuns denied Margot the role of valedictorian because she was Jewish. After graduation, Margot worked at a millinery store in the nearby town of Freiburg.
Rumors started and people were seriously thinking of leaving. And the idea was at that time get the young people out and then have them establish roots somewhere, preferably in the United States, and then have them send for their parents. However, at that point, nobody really was anxious to have it. It was very difficult to go someplace else.
At age 18, Margot Capell took the initiative to apply for a visa to immigrate to the United States. Her parents applied shortly afterwards. Due to the strict U.S. quota system, they were forced to wait. But on November 9th, 1938, all that waiting would finally come to a standstill. That night, she and others in her Jewish youth group were told to leave the synagogue at once.
And on the way home, no sooner, I don't even think we reached home, when we heard a lot of noise and fire engine going, and then we were told that the synagogue had been set on fire. We had just left it maybe 10, 15 minutes before. By the time Kristallnacht came along, then we knew it was too late. They had let it go too far. Nobody had stopped it. Now there was no escape anymore.
By 1939, Margot had returned to Wilsheim to find that her father, along with all the other men in the town, had been taken to the Dachau concentration camp. With the war imminent, Margot's family arranged for her to leave for England, where she would work in a household until her number was up to immigrate to the US.
I was considered an enemy alien because I was a German. I didn't care whether you were Jewish or whatever. I was a German and war was imminent, so therefore I'm an enemy. So I was very anxious to get out. So finally, my visa came through in England to go to the United States.
Margot sent the last letter she could to her parents in Germany and spent the night before her departure in an air raid shelter during the start of the London Blitz. But sure enough, in September 1940,
she would board the SS Beltrover
and sail for a treacherous 14 days before finally arriving in the US.
We finally pulled into Boston Harbor. I didn't come to New York, no Ellis Island, none of that for me. I arrived in Boston, and from there the Hyas took over, which I thought was wonderful. Somebody was on the boat to pick up refugees. They took us to a shelter. They notified my uncle. The next day they put me on a bus, bought me a New York Times, which scared me to death because I'd never seen anything like it, the size of it. And I traveled by bus to Manhattan, where my uncle met me at the bus station.
Margot was invited to move to her aunt and uncle's farm in Hartford, Connecticut, where she had a job waiting for her. And for once, in what seemed like forever, she began to feel like she belonged.
So I managed to get a job wrapping gift package. They trained me to wrap gift package. And I know the people on my floor, there was lingerie, they were so wonderful to me. I mean, I had never experienced that before. On Christmas Eve, everybody came with a little gift. I was so touched, I couldn't believe it.
At that time, Margot was unable to communicate with her mother and father and was only aware that they had stayed in a camp in France before being transferred to Poland.
And that was the end of it. After that, I didn't hear anymore. The unoccupied part of France became occupied, and through all this delay, my parents perished.
Margot Capell would never stop attempting to find out what happened to her parents, although she was never successful. Her loneliness eased when she met her husband, Eric Capell, at a local dance in Hartford. They were married in 1943 and were together for 50 years. Margot worked in different businesses sewing hats and as an owner of a candy shop until moving to Brooklyn and then to Staten Island, where Margot currently lives. Margot eventually met up with her brother, who'd been living in Sweden, when she visited Germany again in 1978. To this day, Margot is active within her community, telling her story to the next generation and spreading her message of standing up to injustices of any kind.
All I can say, keep your eyes open. And if you see anything happen, I don't care how small an incident, do something about it. Don't wait until it grows into a big incident. And don't say, like we do, it will pass, because it doesn't. It still exists. Anti-Semitism exists. It's there. It rears its ugly head. Step on it. Whenever you see something, do something about it. Don't turn away from it. Don't be afraid. This is a free country. The world should have learned something. It didn't. But it's up to us to be vigilant and see to it that it will never happen again. And if we don't do it, nobody else is going to do it for us. That is for sure.
Okay, thank you all, and especially thank you to Margot Capell, if we want to give her another round. One of the big takeaways from Margot Capell's testimony is how, you know, within Enochheim and within the rise of Hitler and the procedure of Heinrich Himmler coming to power, to understand how she was able to be resilient against these fascist leaders, and how she was able to stay committed to her faith. We want to stress the importance of using this message from Margot Capell's story and letting younger people know how bullying or how small acts of violence can quickly escalate into anti-Semitism and these acts of more acts of violence. That's what I find incredibly compelling about Margot's story, and we're going to have her speak for 5 minutes or so.
Thank you, Cameron. Thank you so much for your kind words and for the film. I am deeply grateful. You did a magnificent job. Let's give him a hand, please. Okay. The only thing I can add to my story before I tell you a little bit about my younger years, how insidious, that's the only word I can use, because one day you are with your friends and the next day they don't look at you. It's the most awful feeling, and I have many, many, many occasions to feel that way, but I don't want to get into this again because it makes me very sad. And pleasant memories would be when I was younger, and like I mentioned in the film, we were completely integrated. Then there was a Catholic holiday where they needed flowers, where they needed anything for the church. We were always there to help decorate. And I remember even when I was in school with the nuns, they were so nice to me. Whenever there was religious instruction, they would take me to their home, and whatever they were doing, was it gardening, was it anything else, I would be instructed and able to help. And as I say, that they were very, very nice. When it came to be time for me to be the valedictorian of the class, Sister Magdalene called me outside, and she assured me it had nothing to do with her, which I certainly believe, but the higher ups, whoever they were, and mostly it was outside influence, that I could not speak. Why? Because I'm a Jew. Well, anyway, I'm a proud Jew, and I will never forget it. And all I can say is I had a very nice upbringing. I had a sheltered life. I had loving parents. My brother, who was 9 years older than I am, somehow didn't have much of a connection with me. There was too much of an age difference. However, I had very many friends. I was friendly with everybody, and there was absolutely no difference. And I think of it now today when I can say that 90% of my friends are not Jewish. So that makes up for what happened then. And I think in this country where we all one people and hopefully stay that way, and that would make me very, very, very happy.
Seeing how vibrant Margot Capell is today is incredibly inspiring, considering how much she has been through and everywhere that she has gone. So I'd like to thank Margot Capell again and go ahead and introduce our next survivor in our next video, Arthur Spielman, who Laurie Weintraub mentioned. Arthur spoke about his story for the first time 2 years ago at Port Richmond High School and also at PS 19 as well. So, without further ado, here's Arthur Spielman. The year is 1933. All the way in southern Poland, just resting on the border of Slovakia, is the vibrant city of Krakow, with Jews representing over 25% of Krakow's population. Many Jewish families took up residence. This was the case for Arthur Spielman, a 5-year-old Jewish boy living in Krakow with his mother, father, and 2 sisters.
My father was a very busy man. He was trying to make a living, wasn't easy. My mother was helping him. She was doing the bookkeeping for him.
He attended the Orthodox synagogue with his grandfather, who was perhaps the most traditionally Orthodox member of the family.
I
Sometimes we were playing in the streets, soccer with made out of rags. Oh, I was lucky enough, one of my aunts bought me a real soccer ball. So everybody was my friend.
Yet, after 3 years in a Polish school, rising local anti-Semitism eventually forced Arthur's father, Simon, to transfer his son to an all-Jewish school.
They wouldn't pass me. I flunked. The teachers, they were all prejudiced. I guess most kids passed, I didn't.
This, unfortunately, would be just the beginning of the difficulties Arthur would experience as a child. On the eve of World War II, German Jews who were not German citizens were sent to Krakow from all over Poland.
Were sent to Krakow, and they stayed in the synagogues, they stayed by us. And my mother fed them, and they were telling us all the horrors that were going on in Germany. So I guess we knew what to expect.
Hitler's Third Reich occupied Krakow within 4 days of the war and established their headquarters there.
My father ran away with most of my uncles. My mother and all me, my sisters, remained in Krakow. He ran from Krakow east because all the men were afraid to be captured by the Nazis. They were gone for about a month or so. And the Nazis caught him anyway. It's a good thing that he decided to come back to Krakow and not go someplace else, because if not for him, we wouldn't be here right now.
By 1941, the Nazis forced local Jews to leave Krakow or move to the ghetto, and would often treat Jews with particular brutality in roundups.
They call it the razzia in Polish, you know. They used to come with trucks, the SS used to come, grab people, shoot people. And also, my uncle lived like diagonally across the street. My father's brother, Mr. Spielman, he and my aunt, they had two small children. The boy was about 4 and the girl was about 3. And they wanted to take the kids away from them, and he wouldn't let them, he said. So they shot him right on the spot. And right after this action, my father decided that we cannot stay in the ghetto anymore.
The Spielman family managed to relocate to the countryside, using their foreign Slovakian citizenship as a cover whenever they could. Before they left the ghetto, their close family members were deported.
They went all through the rooms, and then they, us they didn't touch, but they found my grandfather, my grandmother, and they took them.
By 1943, the entire Krakow ghetto, consisting of over 15,000 Jews, was liquidated, and many were killed in Belzec and Auschwitz. The Spielman family made the difficult decision to send 14-year-old Arthur and his cousin across the border to Hungary.
We wound up in Slovakia. We didn't know where we were because on the third day or fourth day, the smugglers disappeared. We didn't know the setup, what was going on. Some of the people wanted to go back. I wouldn't go back. I said, I'm going straight forward. You want to go back? You go ahead.
Caught by a few Slovakian citizens, Arthur was first put in a jail, transferred over to a Jewish committee, handed over to the Hungarian police, and then placed in a Jewish orphanage for a few months before reuniting with his family, who took the same route to cross the border.
Anyway, the whole thing was a miracle. That we are here, we made it through. Because a lot of people that went through the same thing, went through the borders, and they were caught and they sent back to Auschwitz.
Once reunited, his parents decided to move to Miskolc,
and hide with a false Christian identity. Any freedom was short-lived, however, when the Nazis marched into Hungary in 1944. Soon, Allied planes started dropping bombs all over the town.
Standing in line by a bakery. It was supposed to open at a certain time to get some bread. A shrapnel hit right next to me. A few people got killed right next to me. And I slid into a basement. I don't know how I wound up there. And I was saved. Just a scratch.
After many days of hiding between barrels and a wine cellar, the chaos of gunfire and explosions quieted down, and the Spielman family emerged to find thousands of Russian soldiers on horseback and wagons there to liberate them.
The infantry, Russian infantry, all kinds of soldiers, young, old, women, they were coming by the thousands. And I guess we realized that we were liberated. We walked out of that. Still, we were afraid in the beginning, you know, to reveal ourselves because we were among Hungarians.
And yet, even after liberation, many of the survivors, along with the Spielman family, continued to starve and live in fear.
When the Russians marched in, they had no picnic because the soldiers were. And again, the women had to go into hiding, my mother, my sister, because the Russians were, it was a free-for-all there. They were raping the women left and right. They were robbing, going through the houses, taking whatever they wanted. And one day the NKVD came and took my father away. And they thought he was a spy, that he tried to poison the Russian soldiers. It took 3 weeks before they released him. They could have just as well shot him, you know, because they weren't playing games with anybody in the time of war.
In the 2 years that followed, Arthur returned to Krakow to look for survivors, moved back to Budapest, and in 1946 was smuggled into Bavaria to attend school for shoe design in Munich. Arthur's mother would spend the next few years trying to move the family to Israel. In 1949, after continuously being denied entry into Israel, Arthur's family made their final move to the United States and took an apartment in Brooklyn, New York. While in America, Arthur was drafted into the Korean War, got married in 1958, and fathered two boys named Barry and Alan.
I hope to see them grow up, be successful, and live a normal life like everybody else.
Just as his parents had been pillars of strength who enabled him to survive a traumatic youth, Arthur is a role model for his family.
He's a very, very strong person, and he's an icon of stability.
Arthur Spielman is now remarried, resides on Staten Island, and visits his son Barry in Israel. In 2014, Arthur told his story in public for the first time at Port Richmond High School. Listening to Mr. Spielman's story and just understanding like how close he was, in escaping adversity at every turn, whether it was escaping Krakow and then having the smugglers abandon him, or whether escaping a bread shop before a shrapnel hit, or even after liberation, when the Russian soldiers took his father, It's just incredible to hear how he was able to escape all of this and still continue to be, stay optimistic and survive and tell his story. So we're gonna have Mr. Spielman give about 3 to 5 minutes of remarks if you wanna talk about your time.
Hi guys. As you can see, I'm a very lucky guy. I went through different battles and different things, obstacles, no matter where I went. Now I have a gorgeous family. I just became a great grandfather. And for me especially, that's a very big accomplishment. Years ago, my life wasn't worth a dime. As you saw my story, where I've been, and coming to all this, and raising a family, I have a gorgeous wife, kids, grandchildren, and this group, I met a lot of friends over here. We made friends for the last few years. This institution has been great to me. And what can I say? I'm very thankful for surviving and being able to do something for the future. And meeting wonderful people, have terrific contacts. I cannot complain now. I'm a very lucky guy.
We will be going on to our third video now, which is the lovely Hannah Steiner, who will take us all the way to Romania. So here is Hannah Steiner.
Welcome to Oradea. Located in the northwest region of Romania, this historic city serves as the gateway to Central and Western Europe.
Oradea, along with the equally romantic city of Budapest, which sits in the Midwest region of Hungary, is famous for its palaces and cathedrals.
But back in the late 1930s, Oradea was much more than a tourist stop along Hungary's border.
It was a nice city, around almost 100,000 people. It was a lot of Jews, Jewish city, with synagogues and Hebrew schools, Jewish schools, theaters, operas, universities.
And it's in 1937 that we meet 10-year-old Hannah Steiner, the youngest in a Jewish family of six, consisting of her parents, grandmother, and older sister and brother living in Oradea at the time, where she learned to sew, play the violin, and enjoy the great outdoors.
We didn't have video and we didn't have no all the other luxuries. We made our own rag dolls. Sometimes we went to mostly to play outside, you know, we were very little when.
As time passed on, Hannah Steiner would join her mother, Helen Abraham, a licensed seamstress, on frequent trips to Bucharest, where she worked in her mother's own embroidery and seamstress shop. But in 1941, amidst Hitler's rapidly spreading Nazi army in Germany and Hungary, Hannah and her mother came home one evening to find more than just their family waiting for them.
And when we heard that, we were on our way going home. By the time we arrived, the Hungarians were in the city already.
Nearly 75 years after Hungary invaded Romania, Hannah Steiner still remembers the Third Reich's impact on Europe's Jews.
We heard that people in Poland and Czechoslovakia, and we saw the Germans coming to Hungary, Jewish people, but still couldn't, that's human nature, you couldn't understand that that can happen to you, you know? And then all of a sudden, March 19, I will never forget that they took away her license. And then she had no choice. She went up to Budapest as a worker, to work by somebody. And I went with her to work
and the family remained home.
Upon arriving in Budapest, Hannah and her mother Helen were forced to wear yellow Jewish stars and walk on separate sidewalks. But amidst the confusion and persecution, Hannah ran into her future husband, Abraham, at a Hungarian dance. It wouldn't be long till 15-year-old Hannah knew that she was in love.
And then he took us home and he asked if he can come to see me. And then he came and then we went somewhere. I went with my mother and to the movies here and there. And he gave me a necklace with a little locket with a picture and the date.
Hannah and Abraham spent whatever time they had together, somewhat aware that their time was limited. Tragically, later on that year, Hannah would discover that Abraham had been taken to a labor camp. Weeks later, the Hungarian police began to force Jewish families out of their homes.
One day they came to pick up my mother. And I said, I'm her daughter. She said, no, she's not my daughter. She again didn't want that they should take me. And I said, yes, I am her daughter. So they took us from our house.
After being forced to leave their home in Budapest, Hannah and her mother Helen were transferred to a nearby brick factory and then to a Jewish seminary. While Hannah suffered for weeks, constantly washing clothes for the Hungarian police, it was her mother's hopeful words that carried her through each day.
I shouldn't worry, everything's gonna be okay. That was her refrain, always she said that. And we were relieved when the train came and they took us in the train.
In 1944, now age 17, Hannah and her mother were transported out of Budapest in cattle cars, along with hundreds of other Jewish families, to the Auschwitz concentration camp.
I'm relieved that we can have some fresh air. But we saw some flames, and we didn't realize that those were the crematoriums. And the Germans stood there, and Mengele stood there, and said, left and right. Later, when we went in, we asked, and then those who were there already from Poland before, the Jewish people said, you see, there are your parents or grandparents burning in the crematorium. Told us to undress completely. And those young German boys, the 19, 20-year-old boys, just looked at the young girls. I mean, we were young. And they shaved us all over.
Hannah and Helen would later find their cousin in Auschwitz and learn that their entire family, except for Hannah's brother who'd fled to Brazil, had been taken to Auschwitz and sent to the crematorium. With most of the family gone and living conditions continuing to worsen, Hannah and her mother did everything they could to survive and save their sanity.
We were cooking verbally. We cooked that, we cooked, we said this, my mother did this, and you add this, and you did this, that was, we were cooking the whole day.
6 months later, after suffering through long days and nights without food, no access to clean water, and sleeping on lice-ridden mattresses, they were transferred to a nearby labor camp, and then finally to Bergen-Belsen near the end of the war. On April 15th, 1945, British and English forces came in and liberated the camp. But unfortunately for Helen, it was still too late.
When we were liberated, my mother was already in very bad shape. She had typhus and she had a wound on her head and that was full with lice. She said that you're gonna go home and you're gonna meet your brother, but you're never gonna see. I'm not going home and you don't wanna see your sister. She told me that. I said, don't say such a stupid thing, you know, that, you know. And she died 2 weeks after liberation, two weeks. My mother encouraged me and she told me stories and she started to tell me when she knew my father and when they got married and just to make me laugh, always. She was the strong one, and she died.
Hannah, along with the others in Bergen-Belsen, was free from the horrors of the concentration camps. But without her mother, she continued to live in fear. Only weighing 62 pounds after liberation, Hannah spiraled into illness and contracted a high fever. She'd soon be transported by ship to a hospital in a port city in Sweden. Once she recovered, Hannah spent the next 5 years working in a local sewing factory. Hannah finally found hope when a coworker informed her that her brother was still alive, along with her long-lost fiancé.
And a girl, I didn't know her, and we were talking about boyfriends, so she said, oh, he is in Israel. That my husband is in Israel. I said, how do you know? He has a cousin in Sweden, and she said that he is in Israel. Called up the cousin, and she said, I'm going to Israel, but I don't know nothing. If I know something, I'll let you know. Came an Israeli sailor, came to Göteborg. I worked in a factory, the same factory. And I told him the story. So he said, don't worry, I write the letter in English and in Hebrew with the Jerusalem Post. And if he's alive and he's there, he will let you know. So he wrote the letter and I threw it in. And after I came home from work one day, and I see on the, you know, they had a slit on the door, and I find a letter and I recognize his handwriting.
Upon finding out Abraham was alive in Israel, Hannah Steiner took a plane to France and then boarded a ship to Israel, where she reunited with her lover at last.
I went with my friend. So in the car he says, I don't know what you think, but I don't think that I didn't see you for 7 years. I think I didn't see you for 2 weeks.
Hannah still has the postcard she received in Budapest. Translated from Hungarian, it means, my heart races back to you. Sparing no time to get married, they said their vows in a hotel room and have stayed by each other's side until Abraham passed away.
This is when I arrived in Israel, and I arrived the day of the Yom HaTzmaut. And I went with this girl who is next to me, you know. We went together, and this is my husband I met the first time. Isn't that something?
The promise of the postcard she received in Budapest had come true. And more romantic moments were to follow.
And what do you remember?
I remember exactly. He wrote it in the hospital, Hadassah in Tel Aviv. You see, this is not so bad, right?
Hannah would meet up with her brother Julio in Brazil and then migrate to the United States with her husband in 1961. They lived in Brooklyn, New York for almost 40 years until they moved to Staten Island in 2000, where Hannah still currently lives. She is the mother of three children, Michael, Jacob, and Helene, seven well-educated grandchildren and two great-grandchildren, and continues to contribute to several Staten Island Jewish committees. Although it's difficult for her to recall all the suffering she experienced in the Holocaust, Hannah stays committed to telling her story to the new generation so that they may never forget.
I feel it every single minute of my life. The pictures are turning around in my head. They don't go away. Even if you can go in a theater and look, watch a show, the picture is still in your head.
Thanks again for Hannah Steiner for telling her story and continuing to contribute to Holocaust education on Staten Island. And so with this video, we did a little interesting experiment because Lori and I went ahead and met with Hannah at her house about a year or two ago to shoot a new interview, which we wanted to contrast with her older Shoah testimony from the 90s. So when you're watching it, she's sort of having a conversation with her younger self between the two videos that we're cross-cutting.
from Auschwitz to Bergen-Belsen, first to a labor camp, Birkenau, then to Bergen-Belsen. Thank God I am alive because my mother was with me. If she wouldn't be, I wouldn't be here. She was 36 years old. That's all I can talk.
Some people who go through the kind of experiences that you have, they remain bitter for the rest of their lives. They never overcome their bitterness. In the case of you in particular, three of you, you have managed to go forth with a sense of optimism and hope and to conquer life. What are the qualities that enabled you to turn out this way and not to remain bitter for the rest of your lives?
I am the only survivor. And I think that Hitler couldn't take away everything. I have a beautiful family, and that makes me happy. I have three beautiful children, seven grandchildren, and four great-grandchildren. And Hitler couldn't take away. And I was alone in the world when I was 17. I had nobody in the whole world. So therefore, I am blessed what I have.
You want to say anything about your husband? About your husband?
Unfortunately, my husband passed away 6 years ago, after almost 61 years marriage. And he was my best friend.
How did you stay so resilient and optimistic? You led tours of cultural sites. How did you do it all? How did you put it behind you, losing your parents and being alone?
Well, I found out there's two ways of living. Either you sit in a corner on your rocking chair and feel sorry for yourself and be miserable, or you try to take out of life whatever there is and enjoy what you're doing and have friends. And even though I wasn't blessed with children, I have three wonderful nieces and nephews. Unfortunately, nobody on Staten Island. Two of them are in New Jersey. One of them is in Virginia. They come, they visit me. If I need them, they are there. Other than that, I had 50 wonderful years with my husband. Those were good years. So you try, you will never forget what happened. However, you try to make the best of what you have, and that's my attitude. I have friends that sit home and complain all the time, which doesn't that do them any good and doesn't do anything to have decent friends, because the friends got tired of hearing the complaints all the time. So this is my attitude, and it helped me overcome. I had a lot of problems besides this, and thank God I made it until my 96th birthday. So that's it. Thank you.
How did you stay optimistic?
Well, it wasn't easy. Because when we were liberated, the new war started. I was liberated in Hungary after living for 2 years as a Gentile with my parents. We were together, but after I escaped from Poland, we were one by one, not just together. I wound up in an orphanage. I was there for about 6 months. And my sister was in a different orphanage. And then my mother and father arrived in Hungary, and they acquired Christian papers. Little by little, gradually, they sent somebody to get me out of the orphanage. And then my sister to get out of the orphanage. In the meantime, Nazi Germany occupied Hungary, and the Jews of Hungary, within 6 weeks, Hungary became Judenfrei, which is free of Jews. And at that time, we lived as Gentiles. My mother and sisters used to go to church. We learned all the Christian prayers. I acquired a job, I worked. And then towards the end of 1944, the Russian front was nearing towards where we are. And for about 6 weeks, we stayed in a wine cellar because there was bombardment. The first bombardment was the American Air Force bombarded the city of Miskolc where we stayed. It was one morning, at 10 o'clock in the morning, before the sirens were able to sound, the bombs were falling already. And this was the American Air Force. But we survived, like we were lucky. It was all miracles how we survived. Our house split. But we survived. And then we had to run into the wine cellar. For about 6 weeks, we stayed in the wine cellar where the front was going back and forth, the Russians and the Germans and Hungarians. Finally, we were liberated on December the 3rd, 1944. And then another war started, because then the women had to go into hiding from the Russian soldiers. And then, like you saw in the picture you heard before, my father was arrested because he gave a soldier a bottle of whiskey out of appreciation. And so they claimed that he gave him poisoned whiskey. You know, there were obstacles no matter where you went. And then we moved out of Miskolc, he moved to Budapest. And there we couldn't stay much longer either, because if we were a people without a country. We wanted to go somewhere. We wanted to either come to America, go to Israel. You couldn't go to Israel because Israel wasn't a free country. It was occupied by the English. Finally, we got smuggled to Germany. In Germany, I lived for 3 years, useless years, trying to come to America. We had papers to come, but we couldn't get a visa to come over here. It's not like what it is now. So finally, at the end of 1949, we were able to come to America and start a new life. And that wasn't easy either. I was here less than a year, and the Korean War started. And I wasn't a citizen, I didn't know any English, and I was drafted into the army for the Korean War. So that was another thing. But thank God, I was a very lucky guy. And I raised a nice family, I have a gorgeous family, made nice friends, and we enjoy life as best as we can.
Were there any of your Christian friends or non-Jewish friends that would go against the tide and try to, that you could talk to and still were your friends? Or was it everybody?
Well, that's a very, very, very good question. I'm glad you asked it. As far as my friends, my age are concerned, there was just one who would invite me to her home at nighttime when nobody could see me, and she was very nice to me. There was also one family in Rülsheim. They had the movie theater. As you see, when my tape came up, you saw Shirley Temple. In case you got her mixed up with me, it was Shirley Temple, not me. Anyway, that was just Cameron did this. Because at that time, there was one family, their name was Henschen, and the owner of the movie theater, he knew how crazy I was about Shirley Temple, and he would permit me to come to the movies after the room was dark. He would smuggle me in, and I had to leave before the credits finished, and I went out. He had a sister who was also the same type of person. She married somebody that lived in France. She came home to visit her family, and we were very friendly, and she allowed my mother and one of my aunts to pick out one piece of jewelry. She buried it in France, and after the war, she made it her business to look up an aunt of mine who lived at that time in Brooklyn. She returned every bit of jewelry. It was, of course, being buried for years in the soil of France. It was in terrible condition, but I had it restored. I had my father's pocket watch. I had my mother's little diamond encrusted little tiny watch that she wore on a chain, and I had a pair of earrings for my grandmother. So this was a wonderful family. And when I went back to Germany in 1978, the only one I could find was the gentleman that had the movie theater, and he was very sick. I could see he didn't have much longer to live, but I thanked him profusely. And there was also, I think it was a cousin of his. She had the beauty parlor, and she would also cut my hair whenever I needed it, but I had to come in the evening when it was dark. Nobody could be seen associating with anyone that was Jewish, because if you had any kind of professional in your family, they would immediately be fired. So everybody was scared to death. At the beginning, everybody said it's outside influence. It came gradually. Sure, there was a lot of pressure from the outside, but nobody resisted it. Everybody gave in, and it got worse and worse all the time. That's all I can say. Thank you for your question.
Thank you for being such a remarkable person.
Thank you.
If I may say so, you're not just survivors and witnesses, but your stories are heroic and a wonderful exemplification of what it is to be Jewish, if I may say so. To everybody involved with this project, I thought the juxtaposition of the historic details and the footage with the personalized stories made it all so much more meaningful. Then I'd like to leave with this question that seems to be brought up time and time again. You did mention luck. You did mention positive self-talk or the influence of relatives that provided you with that positive self-talk. My concern is, again, from the psychological. There's always a question of nature versus nurture. Do you think you might have been also born with a mindset towards the positive?
I don't know whether I was born with something special, which I doubt. I was always very serious as a youngster, but I learned to roll with the punches. Maybe that's what you want to know. That's all I can say. I don't think I have had any special qualities to cope with the situation. But, you know, whatever life gives you, you just do the best you can. That's all I can say. I don't know if that answers your question or not.
You see, the war lasted 5 years, and it wasn't quick. And gradually, you developed to become a conniver. You know, you fought for every day to stay alive, for a morsel of food. Some had worse times than I. I thank God I wasn't hungry through the war, but people were starving. They didn't have a piece of food to put in the mouth. So gradually, it started like, by us, it was stages. And you got accustomed to it. and you became stronger, and you developed a fight in your body, and you wanted to survive to the next day, and it was a miracle anyway. No matter who survived, it was a miracle because our life wasn't worth a penny.
When the war was over, I was all by myself, 17 years old. And I'm proud what I did with myself. I survived and I did everything the right thing, and I'm proud of myself what I did. That's what I can tell. I have a diploma from Sweden. I was in Sweden, I was 2 years in hospital in Sweden, sick from Germany. And then I worked in Sweden. And then later on, I tried to adjust to America. And I have an equivalent high school diploma at age 49. I wanted to be proud and I wanted to. I wanted to be an American and I love this country. I love Israel very much, but I love this country too. Very much. That's it. And I'm proud of my family. I made very beautiful children. I have very beautiful children. I have two sons and a daughter. One son is a lawyer, and his son is a lawyer. And one is a doctor. And I have two doctors in the family, and I have two lawyers. And so I can't complain. Actually, my son is a lawyer, and his son is a lawyer, and my other grandson is a CEO, and my two little ones are 20, they are in college. So, and I have four great-grandchildren. That makes me proud. I think I did the best thing what I could.
All three of these stories showcase this, but particularly Hannah's story. When I first spoke about Hannah at the JCC a few years ago, I was asked to only focus on positive stories related to survivors, and that is how I discovered that beautiful postcard, those incredible words, "My heart races back to you." Her husband saying to her, "It hasn't been that we were separated by 7 years, but only 2 weeks, even though each of them had been in labor camps and Auschwitz," and I had never heard anything so beautiful. But actually, when my students studied her story, that wasn't the part that resonated for them. What resonated was her relationship with her mother. And most recently, my students just put on a play using these survivor stories. And afterwards, I learned when Joel Babula came to speak with my students and tape them, my student Shaylin O'Keefe, who voiced Hannah's role, said that what really affected her was that she was only 17 years apart in age from her mother, and that she was also 17 years in age apart from her mother, and that Hannah was so close to her mother, that her mother was the rock at Auschwitz, telling her stories, helping her, trading recipes, and that Shaylin also depended very much on her mother. And so I really feel like for Hannah's story, this relationship first with her mother and then with her husband speaks so loudly to how survival stories in the camps often had to do with solidarity, that sometimes we live in a world where the emphasis is on survival of the fittest or competition, and we don't really give credit enough to how much relationships allow us to survive. We don't always appreciate them, and yet that's sort of the critical piece. So I do think that in each of your stories, there is so much individual resilience, but the foresight of Arthur's father, the way he saved the family, the way he kept the family together, is something that distinguishes his story from a lot of other Holocaust stories, because it was very unusual for children to survive. And so without a father, that would not maybe have happened the same way. And the same way, Margot also is always talking about her friends. And I know when she was in her 70s and 60s and 80s, she was leading tours into the city from the Jewish community on Staten Island and other groups. She was really a leader, and she really had this close-knit network of friends. And when you hear her tell the story about the rise of Nazism in Germany, you hear how much it hurt her that all of these friends didn't stand by her, that she was paying so much attention to relationships. And again, that your parents helped you have the foresight to leave the country, and her brother to leave for Sweden in 1935, was it?
34
is just exceptional. I mean, it's just very few Jews were leaving in the year after the Nazis came to power. Most people waited till after Kristallnacht. So I think some of it is the foresight of family and the strength of family and relationships, as well as I do believe the three of you have enormous individual resilience. And when Arthur spoke, I have to tell two stories. When Arthur spoke at PS19, it was the first time we had done the Holocaust education with such young children, fifth graders, and we really didn't know how it was going to start. And we walked in, it was 2 days before Mother's Day, the whole stage was full of flowers, and he turned to these about 80 fifth graders, most of whom, probably the vast majority, were not Jewish, and he said to them, he said, you don't know how lucky you are to be in fifth grade. The Nazis invaded Poland right before I began. I had the chance to start fifth grade. And the students right there were glued to his story, to hear that he was exactly their age when he had undergone this trial. And then again, when he spoke at Port Richmond High School after he finished, a young man came up to him and said, it's so meaningful to me as a gay man to hear that you survived all this prejudice and discrimination. In my life, I've faced so much, and I don't know how I can survive, how I can have the strength. And hearing your story tells me that no matter what other people do to you, that you can survive. So these are just some of the reasons I think these stories are so important. So thank you again, and thank all of you for coming.